does he do? He might go all the way. He gives it away. It's a chance. It'll be a goal.
This is a Swans Blog SwansCast, the number one Sydney Swans fans podcast. Well, this is what we've all been waiting for all season, and what a cracking game it was. We torched them from the first bounce to the last kick, and it was a superb Franklin shot that just ended the game. If this is what we can expect for the rest of the season, then, you know, sign me up. We've got the review, the good, the bad, the ugly, the clown files, social guff, and the usual stuff. This is your host, Justin, and with me tonight is regular Joshua. So, Josh, it was a pretty cracking game and a pretty excellent result to go into the bye on.
Very cracking game. Very happy with what we saw. The culmination of everything we've seen over the last 5 weeks and this seeming intent to change the way we go about business and the way we play footy. There wasn't much more you could have asked than what we got. It was a really, really good game.
Yes, it was a absolutely superb game. So just a heads up, we actually tried to record this last night and we ran into some pretty significant difficulties with our internet connections and various computer issues. So we had to kind of come back and record this again on Tuesday night. So here we are. It is bye week and we are recording 2 days late, so fortunately we're not a dollar short.
Thank you, National Broadband, not so network.
Yes, exactly. Look, obviously the agenda items for tonight's show is the fact that we had a massive 7.5 goal win. It was 45-point win, but we did pick up 3 injuries. So one of the good things about waiting until nearly midweek, Josh, is to get a little bit more information out of the club, but we haven't had an injury report from the club yet or any kind of update as to what's happened. So McVeigh's hamstring was confirmed by Longmire after the match. Reardon and Thurlow both have concussion. Well, Reardon definitely has concussion and Thurlow has head/concussion. So we should get them both back for the Hawthorn round 14 match. McVeigh is more like a round 16, maybe after the Suns sort of kind of return, I'm guessing.
Yeah, Mac around 16, 17 would be reasonable, I imagine. The only problem with Macca is that it's another old man injury.
Yeah, it is a bit. And look, we can go back to 2017. The last time he had a hamstring injury, he only missed 4 weeks. So he did a quad injury. He was only out for 7 weeks. And it's quite amazing for a guy who's 33, 34 years old that his recovery is actually better than players 10 years younger than him.
Yeah, the only thing with Macca, though, is that I think when he gets soft tissue injury, he tends to get a small run of them.
Yeah.
So you kind of got to wonder just how much football he's actually going to get in this year. He's missed a fair chunk because of the quad, and he's going to miss another month or so with another hammy. You got to just wonder, given where we are on the ladder and that the club's openly said that we're rebuilding without actually saying rebuilding,
yeah.
You'd have to wonder whether it sort of plays into his contract renewal or whatnot at the end of the year and who we start slotting in down back to fill in for him and long-term planning for, you know, the squad's development. So
yeah, it'd
be interesting to see how that plays out. And that's going to play out over the rest of the season and into, you know, contract negotiations and even the trade period. So that'll be interesting to watch that.
Yeah, and look, there has been a bit of discussion already about what players could potentially be traded if there were to be players traded out. The most recent one is Jordan Dawson has been floated, not by Sydney Swans, of course. Sydney Swans wouldn't float it, but it has been floated in the greater football media that Jordan Dawson could be someone who could be traded. Zach Jones has been floated for a couple of years now, really the last 2 years. James Rose is another one who could potentially be floated as trade bait. But the thing is, James Rose came in for his first game of the season. He kicked his first goal in 3 years, 3 and a bit years. And he played a pretty good game, Josh.
He played a pretty good game. He butchered the ball a little bit. His efficiency was down, like it was sort of 55, I think. But he played some pretty important link man moments, and his second efforts were pretty damn good. You got to wonder what's taken so long to get him into the side, given his, you know, fairly regular kneeful dominance. But, I mean, for a first game back in seniors, it was a pretty good hit out, I thought.
Yeah, look, there's a lot of how he played that you can see in the kneeful end. Like he played midfield, he played defence, and he played forward. And I thought he did a pretty good job, certainly in the midfield and in defence, surprisingly in defence. They put him back on Willy Rioli and Liam Ryan, and he got in two really, really good spoils in the third and fourth quarter, which were pretty critical in preventing them from getting a goal-scoring opportunity. And one of them was a super late spoil. And when the guy had just about marked the ball, his hand just seemingly came from nowhere and just got enough on it to knock it out of, I think it was Jack Darling's arm. So he was really impressive. I was really, really happy with how he performed, given that he kind of came from nowhere, no chance of starting in early in the week, and he's got a game.
He got a game. He did all right. He had to play a lot of different roles for us. He played defender, as you just mentioned a little bit. He was even defending on Liam Ryan, I think, at one stage as well, and managed to sort of put the body in and get a hand in for a spoil as well. So, for someone who's been predominantly just an on-baller in the kneeful who can swing forward and kick a few goals, he had a lot of different hats this week, and I thought he acquitted himself quite well.
Yeah, he certainly did. And I think, like, if you go back to his goal, the Sydney Swans have put it up on social media. They've put it up as one of the highlights of the game, the end-to-end goal, which started off with a Jake Lloyd pretty typical kick-in, which was almost turned over straight away. It was a horrifying moment. Now, Lears picked up the loose ball, and he's dodged a tackle, dished it to Florent, and Florent's just sprinted out of the pack. He's nailed Tom McCartan on a lead, who completely bossed, what are we calling him, Fatso. He's always got that super small 20 on his back. Took a really good contested mark, dished it off to James Rose in the space, and Rose just gathered and nailed it from 55 metres. It was awesome play.
Good patch of play, and it was a theme throughout the whole game as well. I think if you look at the stats, you'd see that actually some more stats were put out today about how Sydney has supposedly changed their game plan since round 7. And it sort of shows some trends in what we've been trying to do since, you know, round 8 onwards, and that is that despite the fact that we were not playing on as often from marks prior to round 7. We're now playing on even less from marks after from round 8 onwards. And what it actually shows is that our uncontested numbers are up. So we take a lot of uncontested marks in the back half of our field until such time as an opportunity presents itself. And then we play really quickly. And I think that showed in the behaviour of a lot of our guys this week, in that guys like Tom McCartan, who would normally take a mark and then sort of hold the ball up and try and find a target to go to, would literally just turn and stick it on the boot again. And that was also helped by the fact that we had a lot of runners this week. Once the release happened, we had people everywhere. And a really good example of that was the goal that Menzel set up for Franklin. When Menzel, he had no one in front of him. He was on the wing. He took a mark. He had no one in front of him. And Lance Franklin, who's clearly got a bit of fitness about him again, just took off down the field, and Menzel was able to do that sublime little, you know, sort of right foot kick inwards and find Lance on the run, who, you know, then completely bulldozed his opponent and, you know, slotted the goal from sort of 45. It's a really interesting set of numbers that came out this week, and I think it really shows how the coaching staff have been trying to reinvent the way we do business, and I think it's the first week it's all come together for us.
Yeah, it really has, and those stats were very, very interesting, actually. Our play on after mark is, I think we're ranked like close to 18th in the league for it. We were ranked 4th in the league before in the first 7 rounds, and now we're ranked like right at the bottom. Our kick to handball ratio has basically flipped. I think it was 1.3 kick per handball. It was about 1 kick per handball. Now it's about 1.3 kicks per handball. So that's much, much higher. And the time in possession's a lot better. But I wonder if it coincides with some of the players who are known to play on very quickly with the ball after marking, with them being out of the team. I'm talking more your Harry Cunninghams and your Zach Jones. And Zach Jones, that's his trademark. He'll mark it and just sprint. Half the time, he doesn't even know what he's doing. He runs into trouble pretty regularly. And Cunningham does play on a fair bit. He takes a lot of marks, but he does play on a fair bit. I just wonder if, like, the change coincides with those two players being out of the team and they've kind of had to rejig it a bit.
Yeah, look, I'm not so sure about that, because in those games where those two played on a lot, they were games where our midfielder especially was very static. They didn't have a lot of options to go to. They weren't going to find someone in open space or on a lead by kicking the ball. So they sort of had to take it, pick it up and run. But I think it sort of shows that, well, we've said for some time now that if you can't win contested ball week in, week out, then the best thing you can do is control it. And I think what we're seeing at the moment is a real sort of Hawthorn-esque, certainly West Coast the last couple of years, effort to control the ball before you release up the middle. And once we do release, we've got runners everywhere at the moment. It was something, it's clearly what they've been moving towards. And I think we've seen glimpses of that over the last couple of years. We do it for like a quarter and then sort of not carried on. But I thought that was our most complete game for at least a season.
Yeah, definitely. I'm certainly not going to disagree with you on that one. When you say like glimpses, if we go back to early in the season, right, almost every single game, bar the Carlton game, which was a fairly consistent performance, but every single other game, we've had one quarter of like high quality football. We've really been able to play our style of football. So the Adelaide game was really the third quarter that gave it away. The Melbourne game, we destroyed them for the first 40 minutes and then really just gave them the game. Collingwood, we got back in it in the third quarter and it was pretty neck and neck. Geelong, we had our moments and we did have a fair bit of control in that game. And some of the other ones, we certainly controlled the ball well. It's more of a tempo style game that we're going into. But it's interesting you actually talk about the contested ball figures, because we did win the contested ball only barely by 3 possessions. That's how many it was. At one point, we're actually up by about 30. What happened was in the last quarter, despite the fact that we outscored the Eagles by maybe 2 or 3 goals in the last quarter, right? They still beat us in contested possession by 20 odd. So they really brought that back in. Our contested possession differential is still ranked like 17th or 18th in the league. So we're still like bottom 2, bottom 3 for contested possessions in the league. It's just impressive that we're actually using the ball so much better than we were 6, 7 weeks ago.
Yeah, that's true. I would say too that the one patch in that game where the Eagles were able to score fairly freely towards the end of the first quarter, there was probably a 10-minute patch there where they comprehensively flogged us in contested ball.
Yeah.
And I'm talking it was like 20-7. I don't think we have to particularly beat anyone by large numbers in contested ball, but we certainly can't lose it by a large margin. So if you're within, you know, within a bull's roar, it's probably par for the course, but we can't lose it by 20 or 30 like we have some weeks.
Yeah, and well, speaking of that first quarter, we were absolutely dominated them in possessions, contested possessions, clearances, and we're up in tackles in the first 10-15 minutes, right? And then the Eagles, they drew level and then just accelerated. And that's how they got their 3 goals. They really got 3 quick goals based almost purely on good contested work in the middle, and they got the 3 center clearances in a row. So it was really impressive for us to go into the lead at quarter time. And the really good thing was the fact that we led at every single change of the match, and it increased every single break. So despite the fact that we went in only a couple of points up at quarter time, we kicked the next 2 goals, we're up by 2 and a bit goals, and then West Coast came back. We still accelerated. We still kicked another 3 goals. Then we kicked, I think, 5 goals in the third, and we kicked another 4 or 5 goals in the last quarter, and we still kept extending the lead every single break.
Yeah, and I think too that, I mean, we look at Lance Franklin's performance and go, well, that's just a fit buddy. He didn't look fit last week, but he looked like there was nothing wrong with him at all this week. The game from Tom Papley, well, I don't know about you, but I've sort of been expecting Tom Papley to get one and rip it apart for a while now, and I'm happy to see that he's a genuine mid-forward. He can play a lot of positions. He's just not that small, you know, crumbing forward that we originally got him in as.
Yep.
But their supporting cast at the moment is so much better than it was 3 months ago. And that's because of guys like Florent.
Yep.
So Florent's been playing basically 80, 85% game time all year. His ball use is pretty damn good. He's able to run and create. And I think I'd say he's been given license as well to be able to run and create.
Yeah.
He has some pretty cutting runs. Ryan Clark.
Yeah.
Another cracking game from him.
Let's rewind all the way back to like round 4. Go, what the hell have we got ourselves into here?
The butcher. The butcher.
Yeah. No, I remember.
The butcher. So I think he had a couple of center clearances, but he didn't usually start in the center. He'd start on the wing. And then once the ball had been cleared or was on its way out, he would then swap on to Gaff for the first half. Mate, Gaff didn't have much influence on the game at all. Gaff's not a potato. Like, Clark did a pretty good job on him and still managed to win enough of his own ball. So ran as a tagger, got 22 possessions and went at 95%.
Yeah. Which is
the butcher,
impressive.
Ryan Clark, went at 95%.
I know.
Another solid game from him.
Ridiculous. I couldn't even believe it when I saw that stat myself. Look, I'm just having a quick look at the scoreworm. So, and this is the really impressive thing. So when Eagles drew a level with us, or they're about a point behind, right? The Swans then went and kicked 12 of the next 16 goals. And we're talking basically the halfway point of the second quarter, we kicked 12 to 4 goals. We kicked 9 of the next 11 once they drew within a point. So that is impressive, considering at that point we're already down 3 players. And we ran the match out superbly and finished 45 points up. So it's a bloody good win, to be honest.
Bloody good win.
Now, Willy Rioli, sling tackle on Colin O'Riordan. He's been off for a week. And he went off. He was finally taken off. And then it was almost the next passage of play. Nathan Vardy's lined up Jackson Thurlow. And you could see him running in. I mean, Thurlow got rid of the ball and then Vardy's just steamed him and taken him out. You know, a day late pretty much, you know. And he's picked up a concussion and he's been offered another week as well. So Rioli and Vardy.
No, I didn't see the MRO ruling on that. Are they saying there was it was an accidental head contact?
No,
or did
no.
Vardy's shoulder clip him on the chin?
They said high contact, medium impact, reckless.
Okay. So they still didn't say what it was. I'd have thought it was an accidental head clash.
It looked like an accidental head clash, but players have been suspended for that in the past when players on the receiving end have copped concussions. And, you know, maybe purists would argue that's not very fair, but at the same time, I mean, it would be the same as if you hit the guy's head with your shoulder.
Yep.
He's concussed either way, right? And your technique obviously wasn't good enough to prevent him from getting concussed.
I'm surprised we haven't talking about the man whose man babies you want to have. You're going to bring him up?
I'm going to bring him up. I am going to bring him up, but I'm going to bring him up a little bit later. So I'm going to keep everyone on hold for this one. We'll go over some of the stats. So it was a very, very impressive first quarter. I think at one point we'd had 60 possessions to about 19. And the commentators were talking about it. They were in disbelief because we'd kicked 3 goals to about 2 points or something silly like that, right?
Well, at one stage we had like 30 and they'd had none.
Exactly. We had the ball on a string at the first quarter. They just snagged 3 super quick goals, 2 of them through Kennedy. And I can't recall who the other one was from. I think Rioli, maybe?
No, it might have been Ryan.
Ryan, that's right.
Yeah, it was Liam Ryan. It was the one that gave him the lead.
Yeah, it was that fluky goal square one. And yeah, I mean, sure, it was a little bit frustrating, but Tom Papley put in that absolutely magnificent snap over his shoulder to put us back in the lead. So, and you had James Rose in the pocket screaming for the ball and he's going, nah, I got this, and gangstered it through, you know, gangster style. So kudos to him. He finished with 5 goals. Pretty much trust him to have a set shot for my life. Unlike a very certain Melbourne player we're going to talk about a little bit later on.
Treebeard.
Treebeard. The worst set shot routine I've ever seen. So we actually finished 115 disposals ahead. 115. 420 to 315. And we had 1 less clearance, but 16 more centre clearances, 17 to 11. And this is where the stats get interesting. Again, we are, and this touches back on the article that you're talking about, right? We're minus 12 inside 50s, 46 to 58. We're actually ranked in the bottom 4 for inside 50s. However, in the AFL since round 8, as you said, we're actually ranked number 1 for scores per inside 50 and number 2 for goals per inside 50.
It's pretty good.
That is absolutely ridiculous. Our efficiency is absolutely crazy at the moment. It's probably the most efficient this side's ever been.
And that makes perfect sense. If you look at the way the ball goes inside our forward 50 over the last sort of 3 or 4 weeks, it's much improved. We're finding players on a lead. We're kicking into open space and forcing our forwards to lead in there. And we're getting a much more even contribution from our, you know, goal-kicking mids.
Yeah.
So if we're only going to go in there 46 times and generate 25 shots on goal, well, that's awesome, because we're clearly not going to be doing 55, 60 inside 50s. We never really have, and we're not going to change that anytime soon, I don't think. So efficiency needs to be there. And interestingly, that's what Geelong is doing. They're not putting it in that often, but when it goes in there, they get points.
Yeah, exactly. I think one of the most impressive things, if you look at the way the forward line worked on the weekend, was that the players actually led at the ball. They led at the player with the ball. You had Nick Blakey, who absolutely nailed Tom Papley on a lead, which was absolutely stunning. The Menzel one, which you've talked about, we could just go on and on and on and on. But it's the fact that we're actually converting those scores as well.
Aaliyah picked out Reid with an absolute belter of a kick.
He did, yep.
Much improved. The only thing I would temper all that with, though, is that the Eagles' defense was a bit of a bloody shambles after halftime. So, but I think it proves what we've been saying, and that is that It looks like they're trying to change the way they do business.
Yeah.
And I think this is the first week it's fully come off for them.
We had signs of this back in 2017. So if you look at like that first six, seven games back in 2017, this was the style they were trying to play. They were trying to get away from the contested style because while it had been successful during the home and away season, and it was very successful during the home and away season, we finished top of the ladder twice. We go to the grand final and we got beaten in the grand final twice playing that style. And our win-loss record in the finals from 2013 onwards, rather, was actually quite poor. I think we were going at under 50%. So this change has been in the making for a couple of years. And Longmire said, he actually said this year that we tried to do it back then, but we just couldn't get it going and nothing worked. It was like Fremantle back in 2015 when they tried to make the change. They tried to change it, didn't work. They had to go back to contested possession. They had to go back to their style, and all of a sudden they won games. And they were back playing to the same level quality. And I think this time around, last year there was a little bit of a change. They tried to just incrementally change the way the team played, and you could see it, but nothing really worked. And then earlier this year, nothing really worked, but you could kind of see the cogs. They're all starting to turn, you know, that rust is being worked out. You know, they've got the WD-40, the squeaky wheels got the oil, and the last 5 weeks, it's been, people, you can say it's almost a transformation, but we could see this coming. It looked a little bit listless earlier this year, let's be honest. Like earlier this year, we didn't really know what their game plan was, what the game style was, and it looked like they might be without a bit of an identity, Josh.
Yeah, no, that's right. Certainly without a bit of an identity. It also helps that we've made efforts over the last two or three off seasons to recruit young players with good foot skills as well. And that game plan, that uncontested style really requires, you know, the ability to have, not pinpoint, but you got to be a relatively accurate field kick. Which, incidentally, is one of the reasons I really like the way he played Daniel Menzel this week. He's not overly quick. You know, we tried to run two or three tools in the forward line whenever we could this week to try and stretch the Eagles back. But that Hayward sort of role that we put Menzel in, he did really well in that. I was really happy with that. And just before we move on to the next section, I had a whinge last week about the way we played Isaac Heaney.
Yes.
Someone must have listened to the podcast because he actually was at a lot of center bounces this week. And even though he didn't get too many center clearances, I think he only got two in the end. I thought he created contest with whoever he was opposed against, and it allowed your Hewitts and your your Ollie Florence and Ryan Clark's and that to extract the ball a few times, and your Luke Parker. So I thought he had a much more influential game this week than he did last week.
Yeah, he did. And look, I put it up as well in the ratings. Obviously, the coaches thought so as well. They gave him one of the votes.
Oh, yeah.
So we had a clean sweep of coaches' votes. We had the 10 went to Papley, 8 went to Lloyd, 5 went to Parker, 5 went to Franklin, 1 went to Rampy, and 1 went to our man that we're just talking about, Isaac Heaney. So I think one of the other things that has been a key turnaround for us, and this has to go back to the emphasis on Sam Reed learning to mark again. And this is going back like 5-6 weeks ago when I had a bit of a laugh when the Swans put out a bit of a release, and I can't remember which article it was. They said that Sam Reed had actually spent a bit of time that week concentrating on contested marking. And, you know, the average punter might scratch their head and go, okay, why is a key forward now at the age of 27 spending time working on his contested marking? Well, whatever it is they did and whatever it is they put on in that water, it has absolutely paid dividends because he kicked 6 goals and he has been a contested marking beast in the last month. He's barely dropping marks. Like, he's going up for some serious contested marks and he's not even getting close to dropping them.
His return to form has been something quite special to watch, hasn't it?
Very, very
timely. And it sort of indicates what we said all last year in that not having Sam Reed in our forward line, even though he's not often going to be a match winner in himself, structurally for us, having another tall down there was so incredibly important. And I think that's probably part of the reason why they've gone and got this Knox bloke, because if Sam Reed goes down, I don't think Sinclair stays in the ruck. I think he goes forward and either Cameron or Knox comes into the middle. So we clearly function much better. Franklin clearly functions much better with a tall down there.
Yeah, and look, the really impressive thing, I know we kind of touched about on our scoring inside 50 previously, but we had 11 more marks inside 50, 16-5, right? Which is just ridiculous. Teams that are getting 16 marks inside 50 are usually kicking 20-plus goals. Granted, we didn't kick 20-plus goals, but we still scored more than 100 points. And we have been dominating that stat in recent weeks as well. And I think, again, that coincides with the uptick of form from Sam Reed. You got Lance Franklin coming back in. Menzel and Hayward, they're taking their 1-2 per game. Papley took, I think, like 4 himself. So yep. Franklin took more than that as well. So the amount of contested marks and marks inside 50 the players taking is ridiculous. And it's contributing very, very strongly and positively to our massive turnaround in goal conversion and scoring conversion. And we're almost at 50% of score per inside 50 at the moment, which is ridiculous.
It's an insane statistic, isn't it?
It really is. It really is. Some of my favorite passages from the game, I've already sort of touched on that. That's the James Rose goal. A couple of the James Rose spoils too. It just showed how much a player who's fringe to the team really busted his nuts to try and get in and prove a point and show that he belonged. Obviously, with the injuries, I felt with the injuries they were forced to trust him a bit more. And I thought that he more than repaid their faith and he didn't let them down. He went into the middle and won 2 consecutive clearances and he finished with 4 for the match. And he wasn't just like fumbling it out and dribbling it out. He was getting some seriously good possessions coming out of the contest.
Yep. I mean, physically, over the last couple of years, he's developed so much. He was such a weedy little kid when he debuted. And I think that's part of what held him back for so long. Certainly, his effort has never... I don't think anyone's ever questioned his effort. And we've always questioned his disposal by foot. But he always got out bodied too much. You can't really say that about him this year. He's really bulked up.
Yeah, he has. And look, it was impressive. We've been calling for his inclusion since really round 1, round 2, saying, you know, he's only on 1 year. Give him a go. And he finally got his opportunity. And to be honest, he should get another game off the back of that.
Yeah, he should.
And with McVay's going to miss. So I would say just leave him in. Give him a run. Your Thurlows and your Reardons, they're going to be staying in the team. Just give him a chance. So I'm looking forward to see what he can do.
Yep, so am I.
Other players, obviously Malikan, he looks like he's steadily improving. Still looks very exposed in the lead. He's all arms and legs, and he kind of looks like he's about to tilt over at any single point when he's on a lead. But when he gets his chance to intercept the ball, read the ball, and he's under the ball, and it's very static and he's not really moving, his body work has improved dramatically.
Absolutely.
All right, have you got any sort of particular
highlights? We still haven't spoken about your best mate.
Yeah, we're going to come to him.
Your shining star.
any particular highlight?
I know you want to.
Any particular highlight you want to talk about?
Just Tom Papley announcing himself as a bona fide forward mid or mid forward, whichever way you want to put him.
Yep.
He's threatened to tear some games apart before, and he absolutely took this one by the scruff of the neck. It amused me afterwards that the media was all like, oh, Lance Franklin comes back with 5 goals. And it's like, well, you know, he kicked 5. One of them was the absolute definition of a junk time goal.
Yep.
But if I had to pick one of those two performances, you'd take Papley's every day of the week. He was so much more influential.
Oh, he really, really was. 5 goals, 27 disposals, 5 marks inside 50, 16 score involvements, and 2 goal assists. Funny thing is, both Papley and Franklin had 2 goal assists each. Their goal assists were to each other. So Franklin gave 2 off to Papley, and Papley gave 2 off to Franklin, which is absolutely hilious. I absolutely loved it.
George, it's a funny stat for the night.
It is the funny stat
Tom for the Papley. Night. Tom Papley has the same number of marks inside 50 as the entire Eagles team had inside 50.
Yeah. And the amazing thing was Alir had more intercept marks than the Eagles had marks inside 50 for the game as well.
Yeah, that's right. More or the same? The same number of intercept marks in defensive 50 as the Eagles had in their forward 50.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
I found that pretty funny. Yeah.
Poor old Eagle supporters absolutely flipping out on Facebook over that. But George Hewitt, 29 disposals. He had 7 clearances and 6 of them were from the center circle. We put him in the votes. We actually gave him 4 votes. Amazingly, the coaches didn't give him a vote at all. So I was...
You're joking
about that. No. And Alir, my man Alir, who has been a rock star for us in defense, didn't even get a look in. We gave him 3 votes.
No.
He's had like 3 votes for the last 4 weeks, I think. He's been absolutely consistent and rock solid. Didn't even get a vote.
That was a bit of a surprise. I would have thought he should have got one.
Oh, the work he did.
A vote or two. The work he did was sensational.
Oh, yeah.
He covers a lot of ground at the moment. Like, he really does. And those two marks he took on the goal line were pretty bloody special.
Oh, yeah.
Especially when you consider how far away he came to take one of those.
Oh, the second one
he took. The guy's a gun.
Like, the second one he took literally on the goal line. We're not talking like a foot in front. We're talking camera angle was he got his hands on the ball when it was above pad height on the freaking goal line. You don't get any closer than that for a goal-saving mark. That is how good it was. But he finished with 13 intercept possessions again. 9 marks, 5 of them were inside defensive 50s intercept marks. He's going from strength to strength this season. His rise in form has been amazing, and it's been a real joy to watch.
Yep, absolutely.
So who else took our fancy, Josh?
We'll have to talk about his partner in crime in Jake Lloyd with a lazy 42 disposals and 9 marks. I saw something early today. I didn't quite get to read it, that he's where he joins the list of, you know, Swans players who've had more than 40 disposals in a game. It's a pretty distinguished list. It's full of Dan Henneberys and Bob Skiltons and Paul Kellys and the like. So
yeah,
good on him. And it didn't look like it was 42 disposals of absolute nothingness this week either. He looks like he was relatively influential. Yeah. I would like him to get rid of this 2 obligatory, absolutely shithouse crossfield kick-ins that result in turnovers every game.
Yep.
I wish he could get rid of that. But Jakey Lloyd worked pretty hard, and I was pretty happy with his game this week, actually.
What did you think about co-captain Dane Rampy?
Ramps? it was a... you know how Sydney, we tend to do, you know, milestone matches, do a very bad job of them?
Yep.
Yeah, it didn't happen this time. Dane Rampy had a night out for his 150th with a lazy 32 disposals, 12 marks, 11 rebound 50s.
Yep.
And 7-1 percenters. So pretty big night from the flagpole sitter.
Yeah. He's early on in the first quarter, you're going, oh shit, it's one of those nights with Dane Rampy. Kennedy's just killed him twice in a lead, and he looks like he's going to rip him apart at any point. And he turned that around, something fierce.
Yeah,
there
wouldn't be too many people who would be able to defend those first two goals Kennedy kicked. He had miles of space. You know, whoever sent the ball into him knew where to put the ball. Like, it was almost undefendable anyway.
One of those passes was like absurdly good. He put it in almost the impossible angle and impossible spot, and he just ran onto it and marked it. The quality of the ball inside 50 for those two goals were phenomenal. Lance Franklin, obviously, 5 goals, 13 score involvements, 2 goal assists, 9 marks, and 7 of those 9 marks were inside forward 50.
And how much better does he look when he's fit, when he can get some separation on his opponent, when we don't just try and plonk him in the goal square and kick the ball at his head?
Well, it helps when he's playing against Will Schofield, who's basically an equivalent to Callum Mills, and Fatso McGovern, who looks like he can't move faster than one of those old beat-up cars. Yeah, Fatso's a bit of a in-the-hole, I'm going to take my intercept marks and I'm going to look good while doing it. But when it comes to defending players, someone else can do it. And there was... he was criticized by Jonathan Brown, actually, on the show last night on Foxtel, where there was a particular moment of play when Lance Franklin was on a lead and he was leading behind Fatso McGovern, and Fatso McGovern actually handed off to Tom Hickey for Hickey to pick up Franklin on the lead. And of course, Franklin marks the ball in clear space. Of course, he's going to mark the ball in clear space on Hickey. And
Gary Lyon was going off about that during the call as well. Their back line was just not matched up well to us at all. Shannon Hearn plays that. Shannon Hearn goes to Franklin.
Yep.
And stays there the whole night. So
exactly. Last one for us is Luke Parker. He led from the front once again. His upturn in form has been absolutely amazing. He got a goal, a goal assist, 30 disposals, 15 of them contested, and he had 4 contested marks, which was probably the most impressive part of his game on Sunday afternoon.
Well, for sure. Yeah, he's had a big month.
Yeah, he really has. Player of the Year votes, and we're going 1-5 order. So with 1 vote, we've got Luke Parker. Basically, I'm going to have to preface this with it was a flip of the coin. They were all so good, and there was about 8 players you could pick from. But with 1 vote, Luke Parker. 2 votes, Lance Franklin. 3 votes, Alia. 4 votes, George Hewitt. And, of course, Tom Papley with the 5 votes. And he has been rightfully lauded throughout the AFL. He's in the AFL Team of the Week. He's in the AFL Player Ratings Team of the Week. He has, I think, the highest or second highest player rating score for the round. He got the 10 coaches votes. He's going to get 3 Brownlow votes, no question.
Oh, for sure.
So it was probably his best career game.
Hands down. In more ways than one. I'm pretty sure that's his highest, even if you take out the amount of posies he had. I think 5 is career best goals just on its own. So he had a massive night.
He had career best goals and career best disposals. So it was a pretty impressive game from him.
Did you notice he did the little head Buddha rub thing again when he kicked one of those goals?
I don't know what that is.
I'd love to know what that's about.
If you know what that is, guys, listeners, let us know what that is, because we're desperate to know what that is. Josh, leaderboard, please.
Yeah, so top 5 on the leaderboard, 23, Mr. Luke Parker with Josh Kennedy out of the team. Luke Parker has taken over, and taken over he has. On 20 votes, he's a lear, charging up the ladder. 19 votes, he's the skipper, Josh Kennedy, stuck there while ever he's out of the team. 16 votes on George Hewitt and 13 on little Ollie Florent, yep, who's not so little anymore.
No, it's not. All right, time for our break. We'll be right back after this. So, Josh, we've got a lot of people listening to our show these days. What is something you'd like to see from our listeners if they love the show? What is it you think they should be doing for us?
What I'd like to see them do is go to our social media pages, smash that like button, head over to iTunes, and leave us a review. That's the only thing we want from people. If you could do that, that would be amazing.
Absolutely. We love you now. We're going to love you even more. And if you want to see us spike up to the top and sit there on the front of the iTunes page, the Swans Blog, SwansCast, hit that like. Drop us a rating on iTunes and we'll go right up the top, top of the ladder, top of the chain. And we're back. It's time for our champions and villains. So this is it's a bit of an interesting one because it is the bye week this week. So when we come back to do our show next week, we might have champions and villains. We don't know, but it's going to be a bit of a different show. But to do our champions, I'm going to kick things off. And look, my champion this week, Josh, is Reece Shaw. It's hard to look past him as a champion. Sure, I'd love it to be a Sydney player or someone from the Swans, but Reece Shaw is as much a Sydney profile player or an identity as we've got in the league. I mean, Stewie Jew is another one that I think we all kind of love, but what he's been able to do at North Melbourne, and the fact that he's already got the respect of literally everyone in the media, the wider football community, there isn't a person out there that doesn't like him. And he's even having a bit of a subtle joke and dig at his brother coming up to the North Giants game. So he's an entertaining guy, and I think he may not get the job long term, but he's certainly making the most of his opportunity. You cannot say that he's not. He's done well, Josh.
He's a champion. I'm really happy to see how it's turning out for him down here at the moment. It's watch this space, I think.
Yep. Need your champion, please.
Mine's really simple. Anyone who was watching the telecast, or even if you're at the right spot at the ground on Saturday night when the legendary Reg Grundy was doing his walk around the perimeter, there was an absolute legend of a guy in the crowd who handed Reg a beer, and Heath took that beer and walked off with it. And I just thought that was cool. So that guy from the crowd, you are my champion.
Yes, yes. It is a great one. It is a nice photo. There's a nice photo of him up there as well, walking around with a beer. Villain time. I'm doing it for the second week in a row. I can't help it, but it has to be Carlton. And for all the people that have come out and applauded him, there are plenty of people that have come out and absolutely slammed them for their dramatic turnaround, their complete 180 in performance, and have said the same thing that I'm going to say. And look, the thing is, we had these worked out a couple of days ago before people in the media kind of came up and said with what I'm about to say, but where the hell was that performance when Brendan Bolton was coaching? It's not like North Melbourne, right? Did they have an uplift in performance? Yeah, they just tweaked a little bit. Their base was already there. They were just down. But some of the performances were really good. They were like 95% there. You don't go from playing like a bunch of idiots to putting in an absolutely earth-shakingly good performance the next week and look like bloody under-12s from the local football league to looking like an AFL team in 6 days' time. It's absolute nonsense and bullshit. I think the players have to be accountable for that. I honestly think it's a disgrace. I think the whole football club's a disgrace, and to be honest, they should stay at the bottom. I'd love it if the AFL docked them.
You've been tilted about this for days.
Oh, I've been tilted about it. I'd love it if the AFL bloody docked them 2 games worth of points and said, you just stay down there, you bastards, for absolutely screwing us around and making us all look like dickheads. But
You shouldn't have to sack the coach to get basic effort and chasing and tackling, should you?
Exactly. You don't sack a coach because a player can't kick. You get rid of the freaking player who can't kick.
The frustration's real, ladies and gentlemen.
It's just, look, Brisbane completely screwed that match. They had that match in the bag, and then shit, fuck me, fucking Carlton. Anyway,
my Monday villain. The SCG Trust, I'm not a fan of the SCG Trust. I don't like the way they do business, especially, you know, with the shenanigans this year about the ground and, you know, the lack of improvements to some of the facilities at the SCG. So imagine my surprise when they came out and said they have brought in technology which allows people to select the food venues or outlets at the SCG that have the shortest wait times. And I thought, fantastic. Now I can get, you know, chips and a burger, which is colder than my beer, in 7.5 minutes instead of 9. I just thought, you know. Hey,
don't forget, you've got to walk.
Now I get to buy
horde.
Shit food even quicker. So you're more CG Trust.
You got to wrestle your way through the crowd to get to that food stand. And then you got to bump and rub shoulders everyone to get to the front and go, is my shitty meal ready?
Yeah, look, I mean, I'd just be happy to pay full price if it was decent, if it was worth eating. But
yeah,
anyway.
Sorry to worried about rain on all of our Sydney-based supporters who love the SCG, but I think one thing that we can all agree on is that the alcohol service is lacking and the food quality is certainly not as good as it is at other stadiums.
It does make me laugh when people bag out Etihad, because Etihad isn't even... Etihad's quite good compared to the SCG for the most part.
It's good compared to the SCG. But if you actually... And this is the amazing thing. We actually talked about this previously in another podcast. I'm going to move on to Clan Files in a second. But if you actually want really good food and good service, go to Gdynia Park's Guild Stadium. Mate, they have kebabs. Who doesn't love a kebab and a beer at the football? Seriously.
Yep. Yeah, so, I've heard that the Cadinia's got great food outlets.
Oh, they do. The food there is
and it's
really,
warm.
Really good. It's one of the reasons you go down there every year or so. But look.
Didn't get a ticket.
Didn't get a ticket this time. Time for our Clown Files. We have our four nominations and our Clown of the Week, Josh. So I'm going to kick it off with the very first nomination. It is a player who's a bit of a serial shanker. He is an outstanding ruck. He plays for Melbourne and his name is Max Gawn.
Treebeard.
He, oh man, let's go back to last year. He had that set shot after the siren against Geelong. All he had to do was just guide it forward. What did he do? Pulled it to the left. He sprayed at something shocking. He had another shot earlier this year where he missed another after the siren. Or it was pretty close to the end of the siren. It was last week. Wiedemann also missed a chance and they lost against Adelaide. Right. Max Gawn and Wiedemann missed their chances with about 90 seconds to 2 minutes left. Obviously, they've lost against Collingwood. They cannot win. They're already down. The siren's already gone. Has a shot off the siren. What does he do? Sprays it again. He is not a guy you want taking a set shot for your life.
No, definitely not. It's the one thing he doesn't give them. He gives them everything else except for anything in front of goal.
Yeah. Your nomination, please. Your first nomination.
Mate, this made me as angry as a bloody duck on a hot plate when I saw this. And that is... I don't recommend that people go and have a look at it, but Sam Newman has made this outrageous tweet out there in the Twitterverse regarding Adam Goods and the final quarter. I've actually got it here. I actually don't want to read it. Don't want to give him any more time.
It's a shocking tweet.
It's just not anchored in reality. But I can't stand the bloke anyway, and so I just want to clown him because I just think he's a clown and everything worse, so... Sam Newman, you're a clown.
Yeah, it's a good clown. And the funny thing was, people were demanding that Sam Newman come back onto the footy show, but he wasn't one of the main reasons why people turned off it in the first place, because he was an outrageous racist. And some of these shenanigans were like so far gone, and they were anchored in a completely different decade, a different century. That like 25 years ago is when those shenanigans were acceptable. Not anymore. So yeah, look, your next nomination, I believe you've got another one for us.
Oh, I do. Stephen Hawking, you're my next clown, because four years after you got involved in whatever it is you actually do at AFL House, it brought in the goal review system, it still doesn't bloody work. So
no.
Just go straight to the head of the snake. You brought it in, it doesn't work, you're a clown, fix it. It needs to be fixed. The last 3 weeks have been an absolute disaster.
I would go as far as saying anything Stephen Hawking's brought in has completely and utterly ballsed it up. The MRO, it wasn't until like this week that he actually, well, last week really, actually got his shit together and started making good decisions. And even then, they're all borderline. Everything Stephen Hawking has done has just absolutely turned bad on him. My second nomination, and he wasn't far off getting a clown of the week on this one, but Stewie Jew is turning into a bit of a man mountain for all the wrong reasons. There was a bit of a thing when Reshaw coached his first game where he's just smashing down the lollies, and the commentators are having a bit of a giggle about eating all the lollies. And then again, they had Stewie Jew. This is on Bounce on Foxtel after the Swans game, and they're talking about the fact that Stewie Jew's he loves to eat a bit and he doesn't mind a lolly. A guy from the crowd threw a milk bottle into the coach's box. He's picked up the lolly, looked over the edge, and just gone, yeah, why not? Chucked the lolly in his mouth and ate it.
I don't know about you, but having food thrown at me through a window and me automatically just going, yo, I'll eat that, isn't the normal thing to do. So I don't know.
That's what cracker. We got the video up on Facebook. I couldn't help myself. I had to record it on Foxtel because just cracking myself up laughing watching it. But Stewie Jew, I mean, you're a champion for all the right reasons. So yeah, he's our last nomination, which brings us to our clown of the week, Josh. Let's just preface this with he completely and utterly missed the mark on this one. It is North Melbourne goal-kicking champion Wayne Carey. He is our clown of the week. And in case you are wondering, go and listen to the Sunday Triple M Rub. Skip ahead to about the 14 to 19 minute mark when they're talking about Matthew Nicholls being called a bald-headed flog and the fan getting ejected. Then they stumble into the Adam Goods territory. Kind of starts off okay. He says, you know, people were kind of just blindly doing it as well, you know, for every reason they were coming up with. Like, he was kind of coming up with a kind of a good argument. Where he really messed up was when he suggested that Gary Ablett booing, not because he's been suspended lately, not because he's a good player, was religiously motivated. And then he went on to compare the booing of Gary Ablett because he's a religious person to the booing of Adam Goods. And he said, he almost argued that it was worse than Adam Goods' booing. It was mind-boggling. It was the dumbest thing I've ever heard anyone say on radio, except for Sam Newman just spout utter nonsense bile.
Yeah, hold on to your hat, Swans fans, because while these two documentaries about Goodsy come out, so we've got the final quarter, which is being viewed now, and then there's one by Stan Grant coming out in the future, there's going to be more and more of this happening. So just if you see something on social media, do yourself a favor, don't read the comments. Because you'll never if you want to find a place where people can take complex social situations and then trivialize them to ridiculously small soundbite statements, it's on Facebook. It's especially in any thread under a Fox Sports
or Triple
News article.
Yeah.
So,
thing of that was shocking. One of his other hosts were actually laughing in the background while he was fumbling and making this absurd argument. And then Mark Howard just cut him off and moved the subject along. Like, he literally got cut off almost mid-argument and they didn't talk about
it again. Cringeworthy.
Oh,
absolutely cringeworthy.
It was cringeworthy, and it just goes to show that he's... I'm sorry, we might lose the E rating on this one, but he's a bit of a dickhead. So his commentating has proved he's a bit of an arrogant toss, but he's a bit of a dickhead, unfortunately. But look, enough of the dour stuff. Let's get on to our social stuff. So, Josh, I'm going to hand this over to you because you actually put the question out again.
This has been a bit of a flop, actually. I thought I'd get more bites on this. And it seems like that I was the only one who had, you know, who thought what I put up was a good idea. I've kind of been cut down in public and, you know, in private by a couple of the other contributors. So anyway, so in the post-match the other night, Horse said that the game was one of the better wins he could remember, only having one on the bench and still being able to finish strongly. And I thought that I thought we had a challenge to that. So I asked people which was a better win, this week's win against the Eagles or the round 21 game last year against Melbourne, which was the game where Alex Johnson tore the ACL in his good knee at the end of the first quarter. Because I thought I was on a winner here, and it turns out that maybe I probably wasn't. So which was better and why?
Yeah, I'm siding with the crowd here on this one, Josh.
Righto. Well, I'll explain my position at the end of it anyway. So anyway, Chris from Facebook, he says, it's a tough call, but I think I prefer yesterday's game. I think the position we're in this season, the new players coming through and the direction we look to be heading make it so exciting. And you can't really disagree with that, I guess.
Yeah, James from Facebook, he says splitting hairs, but right now I'm loving the win yesterday. So that's a good one. Heather from Facebook, she chimed in. She's a regular, as people would know. She said that arguably last night the Swans fielded a younger and more inexperienced team, along with one less on the bench. So I think Horse had it right. I believe we've got one more there, Josh.
Yeah, Shannon from Twitter. She says it was much better. Amazing game from start to finish. People didn't give us a chance yesterday. Plus, AJ did his knee in a game last year, so it was ruined. Yeah, and actually, that was kind of my point. So I thought that, because we're a young team with essentially 3 months worth of in-game training at the moment, I guess, for our young guys. And we're a team on the up again. Whereas last year, we were actually really struggling when we went into that game. We weren't playing well at all. We had a lot of injured older guys. And I just thought that the devastation, the psychological devastation that happened to the team when AJ did his ACL, for me, that just made that win more gutsy to me, because we could have gone to water.
Yeah.
Could have gone to water and not finished the game. And as it was, we finished with only two on the bench because Smooch did his glute, I think, during that game as well. So,
yeah.
It turns out I'm the only one who thinks that that game against Melbourne last year was better.
Oh, that game against Melbourne, though, that was an all-time great win. I think they're two different wins. The Melbourne one was a very emotional one, but also the fact that Melbourne came so hard in the last quarter and we just hung on, you know, by our teeth, by our fingernails, literally anything that we can grab, we just held on. Whereas I think this week we had one rotation for 2.5 quarters and we still belted the Eagles.
We only had 66 rotations out of 90.
Exactly.
All right, so I fail. Yeah. Next week you can come up with it.
And, yeah, I'll come up with it next week for our buy show. But look, time for our final segment, the good, the bad, and the ugly. Right, let's kick it off with the good. So my good from the week was Dominic Thiem beating Djokovic. And all I can say is stick that up your ass, American sports reporters, who all sided with Serena Williams when Serena Williams got him kicked out of his own press conference. She's a diva, and he made the final, and he took it to 4 sets. So good on him, and he played some bloody good tennis.
That was ridiculous how they stopped his in the middle of his press conference to kick him out so they could interview her. That was just dreadful.
Even worse was the commentary. Everyone was saying, oh, we don't even know who you are. Who are you, Dominic Thiem? Despite the fact he's a fourth-ranked player in the world, who's probably going to be the third-ranked player in the world after this tournament anyway. So, yeah, who is he? I don't know, just one of the top men players in the world.
Professional reporters following the the tennis Grand Slams around who don't know who the men's ranked players are because they're not from America.
Basically,
it's funny that we're on the tennis thing because my good, almost said ugly then, my good is actually Ash Barty. Go you, good girl.
Well, you beat me to this one. You certainly beat me to this one. But yeah, look, Ash Barty, that is a great one. And her story is absolutely phenomenal. She gave away tennis when she was 18 to go and play cricket. She played cricket for 2 years and then came back to tennis. Started off in the 200s, 300s and worked her way back in for 2 years. And she's reaping the rewards now. She's really cashing in.
Can I just say that, do you read The Onion? If anyone has never read The Onion, it's just a spoof news thing on Facebook. So go and read The Onion. They had an article about it that said, actually, I'll tell a lie, it was the Batuta Advocate.
Oh, the Batuta, yes.
Yeah, and it said something like, being a humble, nice tennis player seems to be, related to winning Grand Slams. And it was a real veiled insult to Kyrgios and Tomic, and I thought it was very classy. So she's the Australian tennis hero we've been waiting for.
Oh, and almost every article I've read has just been stinging in criticism. It's been scathing of Kyrgios and Tomic when comparing Ash Barty's performance. And they're like, you know, this pales in comparison to the behavior we usually get from the men's side of things. How good has she been? How gracious has she been? It is really refreshing to see an Australian who's actually nice. I mean, if that ain't as much of a back end as you could possibly give without giving away names, I don't know what else you could say. The bad from the weekend, I'm going with Richmond's first half of 2-4. So they kept Geelong goalless in the first quarter, and then Geelong just exploded. In the second quarter, they put on 7 goals and just monstered Richmond. I think Richmond had 1-5 for the second and third quarter. They kicked 3 behinds in the second quarter, and they were utterly dreadful. They were destroyed in every single category. Geelong just got on top and absolutely monstered and smashed them. So that first half, for a team who, according to the media, is still a premiership threat, they just got crushed and spanked, and they were embarrassing.
They're a scary good team, aren't they, Geelong, at the moment?
Yeah, and we did a better job against them than Richmond did. So that was something to be proud of.
Yep.
Your bad?
My bad. We actually touched on it earlier, and that is professional athletes who remember that they are professional athletes after their coach gets sacked. And I'm just going to leave it at that.
Yeah. Now, if we're talking tennis terms, we're certainly not talking about Naomi Osaka, who's kind of freewheeling backwards after sacking her coach. But yeah, screw you, Carlton. ugly from the weekend. Now, I know this is a football blog, and we actually have barely talked about football things in some of our later segments. But
it's hard this week, though, because we are missing half the competition.
But in keeping in line with that, we have to go to the one of the world sports, the Formula One, for probably one of the modern-day travesties. We had Sebastian Vettel slammed with a 5-second penalty for an unsafe return to the track after he went off. Anyone who watched the race, I would hope that 99% of you would agree with the fact that the decision was absolutely disgraceful. He careened off. He had a massive oversteer. He snapped the corrector, went just skidding across grass at about 150k an hour, and he's just come flying back on the track, and you can see the rear end just stepped out again, and he's full lock to the right to try and correct it. And you can see he's like going straight towards the wall, and he finally corrects it. The steward's decision was based on the fact that there was this micro movement of his head to look at the mirror, and the fact that for about 0.1 of a second, he straightened his steering wheel.
I can't stand Sebastian Vettel. I'd give you 5 seconds just because I don't like the guy, but it was a pretty shithouse call.
It was a shithouse call. You're ugly, please.
Yeah, look, I've actually just put the same thing in that I had last week, and that is the Demons are still shit. they're absolute teasers at the moment. They did a lot right. Like, again, they did a lot right. They won all the contested stuff. They were very competitive in the midfield. You know, Treebeard gave him a real good chance because his ruck work was absolutely sublime. But we're talking about earlier about how the quality of our inside 50s has gotten better. How our efficiency in front of goals is really good. Theirs is just atrocious, and it wasn't that good to begin with. So just ugly. Demons, you're still shit.
Well, looking at the ladder, they beat us, but we're still above them by percentage and points. Their percentage sits at 76. This is a team that played in the prelim last year and looked like one of the better teams to even make the grand final.
Yep. And that's why people go, oh, well, they beat us. And I'm sort of going, well, that's true. But they were expected to be challenging for a flag. And many had us not even making the top eight. So, you know, it is what it is. And
look, let's be honest on Melbourne. They're playing bottom four football.
Yeah, that's right.
They really are. And
that's right.
It's kind of amazing when you look at Simon Goodwin. He got a 3-year extension. And I bet they're enjoying that extension right about now.
Yeah, it's hard to know whether how much of it's a coaching issue and how much of it is just a player issue. They were roundly condemned for coming back from the off season completely unfit.
Yeah.
So that's the responsibility of the players. So he's probably doing as best as he can with what he's got at the moment.
Well, I did like the fact that when Sam May went out there and He played in defence. He kind of looked like his at sea. He didn't really look like he knew what he was doing. And he got absolutely slaughtered on the lead. So it's another club that made some big moves in the offseason and it's just blown up in their face.
Yeah. And the decision to let Hogan go and go in with T-Mac as your main forward has absolutely backfired on them.
Yeah, it really has.
Because what they haven't accounted for is T-Mac now gets the best defender every week.
Yep, exactly. And he's never been a major forward anyway. He's always been a second or third tall, but... long may they stay at the bottom of the ladder, because if it wasn't for Simon Goodwin's 3-year extension, I reckon he'd be just about fired by about now.
No, I think he'd still be safer this year, but if this went on for year and went into next year, I think he'd be in trouble.
Yeah, he might be in trouble. I reckon at the end of the year, if they go from top four to bottom four in 1 year, I reckon he's in trouble at the end of the year.
Yep.
I'm not saying he'll be fired, but I think there's going to be a serious review of his position and whether or not they, almost like a Richmond-like review. And I think they'll look at maybe rewriting that contract. So, yeah. Josh?
Well, there's going to be a few clubs doing those reviews anyway.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. But look, thank you so much, Josh, for coming on again. It's been an absolute pleasure.
Fantastic. Nice to be here. Good luck with the review next week, the mid-season review. I'll be on night shift. So, I know where I'd rather be.
Yeah, we'll hopefully find someone who can fill in your absence for that one. As always, you can follow us on social media. We are on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram with the tag The Swans Blog. We are also on Facebook with the second tag, SwansCast Podcast. You can get in touch with us during the week using the hashtags SwansCast and SwansCast Extra. We will be back next weekend for our mid-season review podcast. We're going to look at how the season has gone, and we're also going to have a look at forward what's going to happen and whether or not, you know, there's a chance we can make finals. It's remote, never say never, but I think we might be kind of hoping a little bit too much on that one. But until next time, go Swans.
Go Swannies.